John lived a simple life until someone introduced him to religion. Listening to his first sermon, his eyes and mind went wide, zooming out beyond his little life to think about the big picture. Thrilled to discover that he too could be a big picture thinker, he returned every week and then expanded beyond his one religion, though some discouraged it. Like a kid in a candy shop, he wanted to learn about all the religious and spiritual big picture perspectives. Then one perspective really zinged him. Now he had an interpretation to promote into the big picture debate. He talked about it any chance he got, online, with friends, everywhere. He felt like he'd arrived. He was giving his own sermons. He got likes for it, though fans ebbed and flowed. After all, there are lots of religious and spiritual interpretations to choose from. But his joy didn't abate because the debate didn't. The debate would never be settled because when you're talking about supernatural matters, there's no standard for deciding which theory is truer. They all felt kind of true, all with some evidence to back them up. That was the fun of it. It felt safe. There was no way to settle the debate other than what was popular. No way John could be proven wrong. Like art that way, trends came and went. Rachel lived a simple life until someone introduced her to big picture science. Listening to her first podcast, her eyes and mind went wide, zooming out beyond her little life to explore the big picture. Thrilled to discover that she could be a big thinker, she listened to more podcasts, watched videos, and read articles and books. She expanded beyond the first approach she heard. Like a kid in a candy shop, she wanted to learn about all of science's big picture perspectives. Then one perspective really zinged her. Now she had an interpretation to promote into the big picture debate. She talked about it everywhere, online and with friends. She felt like she'd arrived. She even had her own podcast. She got likes for it, though fans ebbed and flowed. After all, there were so many big picture scientific perspectives to choose from. But her joy didn't abate because the debate didn't. The debate would never be settled because when you're talking about big picture science, there's no standard for deciding which theory is truer. They all felt kind of true, and they all had some empirical evidence to back them up. That was the fun of it. No way to settle the debate other than what was popular. No way Rachel could be proven wrong. It was like art that way. Trends came and went. Science prides itself on its internal consistency and most of all on its empirical testing. It works great for figuring out what's more likely to be true in physics, but when it comes to the big picture about life, mind, consciousness, and whether AI has real intelligence, rigorous theorizing and empiricism aren't enough to settle debates. There have been two scientific revolutions. The first was way back with ancient Greek philosophy, the birth of math and logic. In a word, formalization, ways to impose rigor on the generation of hypotheses. The second is popularly regarded as the scientific revolution. It imposed rigor on the testing of hypotheses. The first revolution imposed rigor on what's called coherence. Your theories had to be unambiguous and internally consistent. No inconsistent, two-faced, hypocritical, double standards, no talking out both sides of your mouth. The second revolution imposed rigor on what's called correspondence, which involves testing out our internally consistent theories for their correspondence to real-world evidence. The hypothesis that everything in the universe is made of green cheese has great internal consistency, but it doesn't correspond well with real-world evidence. Okay, but what about the hypothesis that everything is made by God? And that's a little trickier. Like the green cheese theory, it's coherent, but does it have correspondence? Is there evidence for it in the real world? Sort of. After all, how else can we explain the great complexity of life without assuming an intelligent designer? Then again, since God is a supernatural being, there isn't great correspondence. Empirical evidence is natural evidence, and God is assumed to be supernatural. God is a posited entity, a name for an unexplained something that the theory uses to explain everything. That's some of the fun of engaging in religious and spiritual debate. God is your wild card. Just posit a supernatural being that explains everything, and no one can prove you wrong. That's why John likes it. Now, you might think that big picture sciences are much more rigorous than that. They aren't yet, but they could be someday. To get there, we'd need a third scientific revolution that would impose rigor on how big picture scientists and philosophers posit entities and forces. I have a suggestion for what that would require, but first I have to explain my controversial claim. In the life and social sciences, we posit lots of technical terms. For example, motivation. When we see an organism making an effort, we assume it has a motivation. That's using motivation as an explanation. But have we explained what a motivation actually is? Not really. It's a force we assume, and with good reason. Living beings have motivations. Some scientists will say that everything has motivations, even atoms, and some are motivated to claim that nothing has motivations. Why do they claim nothing has motivations? Because we've never seen one. We've only seen the consequences of them. Dissect a living being and you won't find a motivation in there. Dig deeper, really zoom in all the way, and all you'll find is atoms in motion. Well, never mind that. Obviously, organisms have motivations. We can tell by their effort. So scientists mostly accept that motivations exist. They're an unexplained force we can count on to explain effort. How's that different from claiming that when we see an organism making an effort, it must have a soul? Well, motivation sounds more technical, but otherwise, soul and motivation are just names for unexplained forces that we use to explain things. Naming is not explaining. Big picture scientists are like virtual engineers. We imagine combining real-world stuff and forces with unexplained entities and forces to build models how we would design living beings. Well, we don't actually build them. We simply describe them in words, diagrams, or mathematical models. In that respect, it's different from engineering. Engineers have to implement their abstract models in the real world, whereas big picture scientists don't. For example, we might say that this real world hormone molecule triggers a motivation to eat. The hormone is a real chemical molecule, but it has no motivations. And yet it triggers this unexplained force called an appetite. Maybe there's some information in those hormones. Information triggers motivations, which triggers the effort to find food. Okay, but what's information? Again, it's an unexplained explanation. It obviously exists, sort of like an entity or a force, but no one's ever seen information. They've seen things that have it, but there's no different from things that don't. Anything can become information, but only when it triggers motivations. So maybe everything's information, or maybe nothing is. Never mind, we can use information to explain things even though it's unexplained. It's fun building these models. We show them off in PowerPoint presentations at conferences and in papers and esteemed journals. We debate, but with no standard other than popularity for deciding which theory is better. Maybe we kind of like it like that. It's safe not having a standard for deciding which theory is better. It's like Little League, where everyone gets a participation trophy and a chance to win a grand prize for the most trendy theory of the year. Even if we like it, we could do better, though it would require a third scientific revolution. The world today seems a very unlikely configuration of matter, given what else is going on in the universe now and what was going on here a few billion years ago. Apparently, new categories of phenomena emerge along the way, motivation being one. Sure, you can claim that the universe was motivated to create our world, or that our world is just one of all the possible configurations, so why not this one? But that's not very scientific. Science is a campaign to find natural explanations for all natural phenomena. Motivation is natural, so science ought to be able to explain it. There is no evidence for motivation at the origins of the universe, or even for the first 10 billion years in our neck of the woods. But here it is, and there is lots of it. A third scientific revolution would impose rigor on positing entities and forces. I suggest a new standard. It's simple. I call it emergent reductionism. It's different from reductionism. Reductionism assumes that all there is in the universe is atoms in motion, so all explanations must be reduced to that level, the simplest possible level. Why? Because that's all there is. Nothing new under the sun, no entities and forces ever emerge. Scientists reject reductionism. Even the few scientists who defend reductionism are motivated to defend it and therefore aren't walking their talk. Emergent reductionism is different. Once we've explained how motivation emerged from the matter in motion that preceded it, we can reduce our explanations to it, to motivation. Until then, we have to remember that motivation is an unexplained force that we're using in our explanations. The same goes for information, effort, interpretation, drives, even function or fittedness, and all the other unexplained entities and forces that scientists and philosophers posit. Darwin employed emergent reductionism. For his theory, he assumed individuals struggling for their own existence and explained how they would evolve adaptations and speciation through natural selection. Some of his supporters celebrated his explanation for life. Darwin didn't buy it. He knew he didn't explain organisms and their struggle for existence. He knew that his theory was built on unexplained assumptions and that the burden remained on science to explain them, to explain motivation, the struggle for existence, and individuals, organisms. Emergent reductionism worked to explain how forces and entities emerge from what precedes them. Once you've explained their emergence, you can reduce your theory to them. For example, once you've explained how motivation emerged from matter and motion, you can reduce your theory to motivations without having to reduce your theory all the way down to atoms in motion. Emergent reductionism is especially important for explaining the essential assumed entities and forces in the life and social sciences. Motivation, information, effort, you can't do biology without them, and they're currently unexplained. Of course, we can't explain everything back to the very origins of the universe or down to the infinitesimal bit of time and space, but that's not really a problem when it comes to explaining motivation, information, and effort. Life and its motivated information interpreting struggle for existence emerges within nothing but simple chemistry. We don't have to wait until the dust settles in quantum mechanics to explain them. Emergent reductionism would impose a standard for deciding which theories are better. But maybe we really don't want that. Maybe we're having too much fun debating our abstract theories with no way to decide which is better and no way to be proven wrong.